Is it possible for a heavy metal band to replace their longtime lead singer and maintain their success? Hey everybody, this is Kennedy from None More Metal, and in this video I attempt to answer that question. In 1993, Anthrax replaced their longtime lead singer Joey Belladonna, who had been with the band for 5 albums, with John Bush, who had previously been in Armored Saint. Anthrax went on to record 4 studio albums with John Bush over the course of a decade. In this video I'll talk about those 4 albums, rank them relative to one another, and talk about John Bush's general impact on Anthrax. With that, let's get to the rankings. Coming in at number 4, making it the worst John Bush era Anthrax album, is Volume 8, The Threat Is Real. Volume 8 was released in 1998, which puts it right between the grunge and nu metal eras. This wasn't a particularly great time for traditional thrash metal bands, and like some of their contemporaries, Anthrax was suffering from a bit of an identity crisis. Having said that, Volume 8 is still a good metal album with some excellent tracks. Crush, Killing Box, and Alpha Male are some solid Anthrax songs which stand up to anything on the next 2 albums on this list. As with all Anthrax albums, drummer Charlie Benante was the primary songwriter, with Scott Ian and John Bush contributing lyrics. This album doesn't have a lead guitar player listed in the credits. Charlie plays most of the solos on the albums, and Dimebag Darrell provides guest solos on the songs Inside Out and Born Again Idiot. Guest appearances by Dimebag proved to be a common occurrence on the albums in this list. While researching this list, I found the general consensus among Anthrax fans to be that Volume 8 is their overall worst album. I agree that this is one of their weaker efforts, but I'm not down on it as much as a lot of people are. Next up is We've Come For You All, the final Anthrax album featuring John Bush. This album is also the first to include lead guitarist and co-producer Rob Caggiano. As the follow-up to Volume 8, We've Come For You All feels a bit like a rebound. The songwriting is stronger while at the same time being more varied. The trio of What Doesn't Die, Superhero, and Refuse to Be Denied starts off the album super strong. The next song, Safe Home, is one that the band was particularly proud of. I distinctly remember Scott Ian mentioning in interviews at the time that he thought it was the best song Anthrax had ever recorded. It's a good song, but I don't think it's anywhere close to Anthrax's best. I suspect that even Scott might walk that statement back at this point. Rob Caggiano's involvement has a twofold impact on the quality of the album. The leads are better than those on the Volume 8 and Stomp 42 records, and the production is excellent. Caggiano would go on to record 2 more albums with Anthrax before departing and, eventually, joining Volbeat. Dimebag Darrell once again makes an appearance with guest leads on Cadillac Rockbox and Taking the Music Back. Before moving on to the next album, I'd like to ask you to take a second and like this video and subscribe to my channel. If you're a fan of bands like Anthrax and appreciate content like this, liking and subscribing is the best thing you can do to help ensure that I am able to keep publishing videos. Coming in at number 2 is Anthrax's 1995 release, Stomp 442. This is the 2nd of 4 albums the band recorded with John Bush, and it set the tone for the remainder of their collaboration. For me, there's not a huge difference quality-wise between Stomp 442, Volume 8, and We've Come For You All. Having said that, of the 3, I think Stomp 442 is slightly better than the other 2. Random Acts of Senseless Violence and King Size are 2 of the best songs the band recorded during this era, and I also really like American Pompeii and Tester. Stomp 442 was Anthrax's first album without Dan Spitz on lead guitar, and in fact, the album credits list no lead guitarist. Paul Crook, who would later tour with the band, provided guest solos on 4 songs. Dimebag Darrell also makes guest appearances on the songs King Size and Riding Shotgun. These were Dime's first recorded collaborations with Anthrax. Stomp 442 is a good album, which marks a turning point in Anthrax's career. Where The Sound of White Noise sounded like a continuation of what the band had been doing with Joey Belladonna, but with a new singer, Stomp 442 signals the beginning of the sound that makes up the majority of the John Bush era. The songs are shorter in general and less complex. This isn't necessarily a criticism, but for many longtime Anthrax fans who grew up on the albums like Among the Living and Persistence of Time, it was a jarring change. Before revealing the number 1 John Bush era Anthrax album, I want to give an honorable mention to The Greater of Two Evils. The Greater of Two Evils is an album of Joey Belladonna era songs that the band re-recorded in 2004 with John Bush on vocals. For fans that love John Bush's voice but preferred the band's earlier albums, this is the best of both worlds. There are a bunch of Anthrax classics on here, and it's really cool to hear them with John singing. Metal Thrashing Mad, Caught in a Mosh, Among the Living, Indians, I Am the Law, Be All End All, they're all on here. If you're a fan of any era of the band and have somehow not heard this album yet, I highly recommend that you check it out. Coming in at number one is The Sound of White Noise, an album I consider to be as good as any the band has ever recorded. The Sound of White Noise was released in 1993 and is the first to feature John on vocals. This album marks the beginning of the transition from the straight thrash metal of the early albums to the more rock, grunge, and alternative-influenced sound of the latter John Bush albums. In my opinion, The Sound of White Noise is the perfect mix of all of those influences. Right from the opening of Potter's Field, people who were curious about why Anthrax would replace Joey with John got their answer. The grittier, lower-register vocals lend themselves perfectly to the serious subject matter covered on the record. This isn't a criticism of Joey, whose vocals I also love. I just feel like John's singing style fits the tone of the songs that the band was writing a little bit better. It might be blasphemous to say, but there are even some songs from the Joey Belladonna era which appear on The Greater of Two Evils, which I prefer with John singing. There are so many great songs on this album, it's hard to pick only a few to highlight. My personal favorites are Room for One More, Packaged Rebellion, Invisible, and This Is Not an Exit. Each of these is an example of the band at its peak, both musically and lyrically. This album is far removed from the days of goofy comic book imagery and humorous song lyrics. Some Anthrax fans are fully devoted to the Belladonna era and look down on the albums the band recorded with John Bush. I'm not one of those people. I thoroughly enjoy all the albums on this list, and I think Anthrax made the right decision to bring in John in the early 90s. I'm not sure they would have survived the 90s had they continued on the path they were on with State of Euphoria and Persistence of Time, considering the musical climate at the time. So those are my rankings of the Anthrax albums featuring John Bush. In the future, I intend to rank all of the Anthrax albums as well as just the albums featuring Joey Belladonna. Thanks for watching, and I'd love to hear your opinions in the comments. Also, if you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.